Veena Punacha, our former director. It's a great pleasure and a great honor, I should say, Veena, to have you with us. You're there, so we really look forward to your lecture today. And now I will request Dr. Sangeeta Desai to introduce our guest. So over to Sangeeta. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Putul Sate. Welcome to the fourth session of the month-long series of the Gender Sensitization and Capacity Development Program organized by RCWS in collaboration with UGC. Today's resource person is eminent academician Professor Veena Punacha, former director of the Research Center for Women's Studies, RCWS, at SNDT Women's University. She was also the honorary director of the Center for Rural Development. Professor Punacha has many accolades to her credit, a teacher and a mentor par excellence. She is the recipient of the Best Teacher Award from SNDT Women's University during its centennial celebrations in the year 2015. She has received the Pride of India Maharashtra Award from WCRC Leaders Asia for her special contribution to education in 2016. During her long academic career, she has contributed significantly to the growth of women's studies scholarship through her research, publications, and teaching. It was due to her tireless efforts and under her stellar leadership that the Dr. Ababai Wadia and Dr. Bomanji Khurshidji Wadia Archives for Women was set up at the university. So the main aim of the archive is to preserve the histories of women of 20th century, and the credit goes to Professor Veena Punacha for setting up it at the university. She was also instrumental in starting the RCWS teaching program through the introduction of MA and PhD programs in women's studies in the year 2012. It is during her tenure as the director of women's studies that various research programs and research university initiatives and publications were brought out by the center. Professor Punacha was herself mentored by none other than Professor Neera Desai, the pioneer of women's studies in India. It was the initiative and efforts of Professor Punacha that the Neera Desai Memorial Lecture Series commenced at RCWS from the year 2009. Professor Punacha has undertaken research across India, particularly in Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, for national and international agencies to investigate state community responses to domestic violence, self-help groups, and gender issues in educational, scientific, and private sector. Apart from the research, she has contributed to women's studies through her various writings. Her scholarly articles regularly feature in the prestigious journals and publishing houses such as Economic and Political Weekly, Sage Publications, and many more. Professor Punacha has done path-breaking work in the field of women's studies. Her book, From the Land of a Thousand Hills, Portrait of Three Women of Coorg in South India, which focuses on the qualitative methods of research, is taught in international universities. She has a long record of publications to her credit. Professor Punacha's expertise was sought both at the state and the national level. She was the consultant to the Prime Minister's High Level Committee, Government of India, to investigate the situation of women in India. She was on the task force on microfinance constituted by the Chief Minister of Maharashtra in 2008. She was advisory board of various state committees for women, including MAVIV, Mahila Arthik Vikas Mahamandal. She also spearheaded the minority report, which was initiated by the Maharashtra State Minority Commission. She was the executive committee of Indian Association for Women's Studies and many other committees too. After her retirement, she moved to Coorg, which is her hometown in Karnataka. Ecological concerns are very dear to her heart, and her recent articles are mostly focused on the devastation of natural resources and conflict between man and nature. Apart from a great academician, scholar, and writer, she is a great human being who continuously inspires the younger women studies scholars. She instills the spirit of feminism and raises critical consciousness of everyone whom she comes across. Her classroom is a place where young scholars can, without any inhibitions, express their views. She is always ready to explore new ideas and encourages dialogues and debates to strengthen the basic concepts of her students. A great scholar, a great teacher, mentor, and more importantly, a genuinely wonderful person. Let us welcome Professor Veena Punacha. There is a small instructions to the participants. Please mute your audios and videos during the lecture. After the 40-minute session, there will be a question and answer session for 10 minutes, and you are welcome to put the questions in the participant chat box. At the end of the sessions, your questions will be addressed. Let us again welcome Professor Veena Punacha.
Thank you, Sangeeta, for this very warm welcome. And I'd like to thank both Putul and Vatsala for having invited me to participate in this lecture. It was indeed my proud privilege to have been part of the Research Center, the institution which has the distinction of being the first women's studies center in the university system. This great achievement of the Research Center for Women's Studies was possible because it's part of the SNDT Women's University, a university which draws its inspiration from our nationalist and social reform movement of the early 20th century. My talk today is on the ecological devastation of and state policies and humanitarian crisis during the time of the pandemic which we are facing today. As is well known, this pandemic is a zoonotic disease. It has crossed over from the wild, just as other zoonotic pandemics have occurred earlier in the 20th century. This is because of the willful transgressions that we have as human beings have done into our forest areas. The human cost of the pandemic has been studied in many other academic forums. So my purpose here is to discuss the link between the ongoing environmental devastation of the Western Ghats. This ongoing ecological devastation of the Western Ghats has aggravated the humanitarian crisis during the pandemic. My perspective, as Sangeeta has indicated, is now in Kurgu, a tiny district located on the slopes of the Western Ghats. As indicated in other studies, this pandemic has affected the economy. It has had a disastrous impact on the local economy. The worst affected are the business community, the artisans, the self-employed, and the landless agriculture laborers. I must say, my perspective is from Kurgu. The district administration worked very well to minimize the tragedy which was going on. For those below poverty line, they were given free rations, and even today they get about 7 kgs of rice and 5 kgs of wheat. During the first 3 months, they received both dal, free gas, and other miscellaneous items. The local panchayats were also good enough to accommodate the agricultural migrant workers and ensured that they received rations. What we also noticed was that many plantation owners, coffee plantation owners in Coorg, made sure that housing was provided for the migrant workers and made sure that they had work, ongoing work, like topping of trees, weeding of their land. This perspective, I admit, is impressionist based on discussions with people, the farmers, the service providers, the carpenters, etc., and it's not a systematic study. This issue, no doubt, must have been more acute than I'm presenting before you, because most of the laborers wish to go back to their far-flung home. Perhaps the agriculture season was round the corner and their work was needed back home to till the, to, for the transplanting work. The humanitarian crisis in Korgu has been aggravated by the destruction of crops, property, houses, and human beings. A fortnight ago, the head priest of the temple dedicated to the river goddess Kaveri was destroyed. The house, he himself, his entire family, the coffee estate, the cattle shed was entirely destroyed with the landslip on the Brahmagiri hill. His body was found 2.5 kilometers away from his home, more than 4 or 5 days. The sheer scale of the devastation is unimaginable. The destruction of the Brahmagiri hill, the flooding of the rivers, leaving many villages isolated and without potable water, food, electricity, and hospital facilities, is something which has become a yearly phenomena since 2018. In 2018, 35 villages from 6 gram panchayats in Madikeri and Somwarpet Taluk were destroyed. 13 villages disappeared without a trace. These were villages bustling with life, coffee estates, paddy fields, cattle sheds, and houses. It is as if none of these houses ever existed. You could imagine a scale of devastation that would have occurred during the Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa times. The landslides have destroyed highways, villageways, newly constructed housing colonies. And what we also see is that the year 2019 was a cruel replay of what happened then. The ironic difference was the epicenter of the devastation shifted to the northern part of the district. The torrential rains again buried the villages of Thora, Nellahudkeri, and Makuta. Koog, promoted as a tourist destination, is a potentially dangerous terrain. The main reason for the catastrophe is the inability of the terrain to withstand the full force of the rain because of extensive deforestation. Geologists agree that the rains alone, due to climatic change, could not have caused this huge havoc. It has been aggravated by deforestation, which resulted in the formation of hydrogeological cavities in the mountainous substratum. Until recently, the coming of rain after the sweltering heat was a period of happiness for the farmers. The sweet smell of the earth lingers in the air we breathe. To the farmers, the rain marks the beginning of the agricultural operations, a time for planting and nurturing the earth. But since the last 3 years, they have lost their certainty because the earth is no longer safe for them. Their once invincible mountains appear fragile and unable to withstand the force of the rain. The problem is compounded by the growing animal and human conflict. On 15th August, as the nation celebrated its Independence Day, a woman of great vitality and charm, Nina, was trampled by a wild elephant as she was walking near her home. This was not a stray incident, but one of the many that occurs year after year. Children going to school early in the morning have been trampled. Plantation workers find it difficult to refuse to go and work in their estate out of fear. People are afraid to return home a little late in the evening. These are connected problems. Human and animal conflicts have increased because of the devastation of the earth, human encroachment into forest land, and wrong forest policies which focus on commercial forestry. The destruction of Koog is the tip of the iceberg. In the last 3 years, Karnataka has witnessed several landslides in Dakshina Kannada, Chikmagalur, Hasan, and Urpi. Similarly, the weather conditions have become very erratic. 130 talukas in 2019 were either affected by drought or floods. More than 2155 people have lost their lives and people have been injured, maimed, more than 2,48,000 forced to live in relief camps. Karnataka's neighboring state, Kerala, has also suffered extensive damage since 2018. The Ghat districts of Wayanad, Malappuram, Kannur, Idukki have been badly affected by deforestation and unplanned construction of buildings. In Munnar this year, 80 people have been buried alive by landslides. Beyond doubt, the devastation of the Western Ghats is because of decades of unhealthy land use policies, uncontrolled forest encroachment, deforestation, sand mining, and quarrying. For centuries, the forest protected the land through its biomass. It prevented sand erosion, land erosion, which caused landslips. The true import has, the destruction of Western Ghats because of landslips has received very little attention in the public domain. Much of this landslip, as pointed out by S. Chandrasekhar, chairperson of the Western Ghats Task Force, is because of the large-scale deposition of excavated debris and loose soil because of road widening and other construction activities. Now, despite the scale of the devastation, state policies in Karnataka do not seriously assess environmental concerns while initiating infrastructure projects. That these projects will destroy the natural habitat of countless endangered species and impact indigenous communities and cultures do not seem to be of any consequence to policy planning. What else could justify the apparent amnesia in policy planning over drought, floods, and landslides? I do agree that this year, the disaster management plan was effective and helped to prevent a huge humanitarian crisis during the monsoons. But the tragedy is that the policymakers forget the root cause of the environmental destruction. As you can see, my concern for the environment does not spring from an abstract location. It springs from a deeply felt pain because I have seen once thriving villages buried under sludge flowing down mountain slopes. And so I would like to ask about this deeply felt amnesia regarding environmental damage. Living as we do in the midst of a pandemic, which many writers have seen as caused by the destruction of forest land, can we turn a blind eye to the destruction of the forests in the name of development? The frequency of environmental devastation is a warning which cannot be ignored. The Western Ghats is a very complex ecosystem. It's spread over 16,428 kilometers. It runs across six states for a distance of about 1,500 kilometers. It's a very complex system comprising gentle hills, lofty mountains, clothed in tropical forests and grasslands. It's a unique system not found anywhere else in the world, and it is inhabited by a range of endemic plants, animals, and birds not found anywhere else in the world. It is the heritage of this country which should not be destroyed. The rivers that cascade from the mountain, the Godavari, the Tungabhadra, Bhima, Tapi, Kaveri, are vital for the survival of more than 245 million people living in Peninsular India. The destruction of this forest through indiscriminate promotion of tourists threatens the livelihood and cultures of indigenous people who have lived in this ancient land. The impact of the disaster will be felt particularly in Karnataka, which has a total of 44,448 kilometer area of Western Ghats. And out of the 30 districts of Karnataka, 11 lie either partly or wholly in the eco-sensitive region of the Western Ghats. Any tampering of this ecospace comprising a variety of forest systems, unique and distinctive in its own way, will destroy our heritage and our people's heritage. It will also be a death knell to the towns and villages dependent on the rivers that flow down the mountain slope. For only way to preserve the river is to ensure that the riparian forests are not destroyed. Now, both the Gadkil Committee report and the Kasturi Rangan report have agreed that it's the human-centric activities that have destroyed the biodiversity of the Ghats. The Madhav Committee report, based on sound environmental advice, was resisted by local community is because they felt it prevented their income generation activities. Therefore, the Dr. Kasturi Rangan report was established, but even this watered down environmental recommendations was seen as problematic. And as Dr. Gadgil warned many years ago, the destruction is something that will occur not in some distant future, but is waiting to happen. What we can expect is that repeated calamities of a larger scale, and the greatest tragedy is that people have not learned. What we also see that at a time when we are faced with the consequences of environmental catastrophes, the state government is in a hurry to carry out projects with the apparent sanction of the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. It has used this period of the lockdown to circumvent public opposition and initiated 30 development projects in protected areas of this country. It must be noted that the haste in which these environmental clearances have been given is in contravention with the Environment Protection Act. This act empowers the Ministry of Environment and Forests to take measures that it feels necessary to protect and improve the quality of the environment and prevent pollution control. But most of these controversial projects, sadly, is on the Western Ghats, and it is in the eco-sensitive zones of the Western Ghats. These sanctions were obtained from the National Board of Wildlife through video conferencing without careful consideration of the environmental impact of projects. It is perhaps indicative of what is the future where environment is concerned. Some of these controversial projects are the Karnataka Power Corporation Limited to undertake geotechnical survey inside the Sharavati Lion Tail Macaw Sanctuary in Shimoga district, the Hubli-Ankola Railway Project, the Kaiga Automatic Power Plant Units 5 and 6 expansion, the Sharavati Pumped Storage Hydroelectric Project, and these projects proposed at a whopping cost will do untold havoc to the environment. The Hubli-Ankola Railway Project, for instance, will cost about 3,749 crores. It will destroy 596 hectares of protected area and destroy about 1,78,325 trees. There is no real justification for this destruction because there already is a railway line about 80 kilometers north. The Kaiga Atomic Power Plant Unit at the cost of 21,000 crores will destroy 54 hectares of forest land. It will result in the felling of 8,700 trees. The destruction will be on an unimaginable scale inside the Kaiga Tiger Reserves. Similarly, the Sharavati Pump Storage Hydroelectric Project at a cost of ₹4,862 crores will destroy 150 hectares of forest land at the Sharavati Lion Tail Macaw Sanctuary. And finally, Kodagu will be fragmented with at least four railway lines cut intersecting the city to provide connectivity between Mysore, Kushalnagar, Madikeri, and Mangalore. Chamrajpet, Hadsepari, Kushalnagar, Bitangala, Talasheri. The sad thing is that there are already roadways. We are not organizations like the wildlife group in Kodagu. They are not against, and the Model Forest Trust, etc. They are not against roads. They say repair the present roads, maintaining the fact that these are ghat roads. It cannot be expanded into multi-lane roads. These projects will be a death knell to the Western Ghats, and we cannot forget that between, which has been devastated throughout history, particularly between 1920 and 1940, 40% of the Western Ghats' natural vegetation was destroyed to commercial crops. And in independence of, and after independence, between 1950 and 1980, about forest-based industries were started, which destroyed the Ghats. Now, sadly, because of people's movements like the APCO and the, I would say the CHIPCO, various environmental laws were brought in to protect our environment. Among these include Wildlife Protection Act, Indian Conservation Act, Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Rights Act, known as the Forest Rights Act. But none of these have served their intended purpose. These are because the FRA has not really empowered the people with the knowledge of their rights. Currently, there are attempts to weaken environmental protection laws in the name of development and increase the powers of the state over forest resources. There are two important pointers in this direction. The first is the draft Indian Forest Amendment Bill of 2019, which in effect arms the state with unlimited power. The forest officials with and with forest officials will be allowed to carry firearms with impunity and acquire land for public purpose using the Land Acquisition Act of 1894. Similarly, the most recent issue of concern is the Draft Environment Assessment Rules Bill of 2020. This notification was issued by the Union Government of India March this year, when all the environmental groups and people generally were paralyzed by the pandemic and the public interest was diverted. What this bill suggests is that environmental norms that are necessary to protect the ecosystem will be weakened. Any modification of such regulatory mechanisms can be disastrous. The gas leak of LG polymer plant in Vishakhapatnam in on 7th May this year is the latest example. The plant did not have environmental clearance. Jairam Ramesh calls the draft EIA 2020 as anti-democratic, anti-environment, and anti-public. The draft EIA reduces the scope of participation of local communities in decision making, and this is in violation of the forest people's rights. The draft rules will exempt large projects from prior environmental clearance. It includes coal, minerals, sand, solar plants, sugar, cement, polymer, plastic manufacturing units, chemical factories, and the manufacturing of explosives and detonators. These projects can also obtain post facto sanctions and regulate any violations. The public notice period for public opinion is reduced to 20 days instead of 30. No, there is no possibility of environmental clearance, monitoring, and local people cannot complain of what happens to their environment. This notification is aimed to reverse whatever environmental norms were instituted through the Environmental Protection Act. There are 17 lakhs objections to it, and we hope that the EIA will be withdrawn. The writing on the wall is clear. The time to put off the inevitable questions about human relationships to nature is long past. It is now time to accept the assumption that human capacity to control and modify nature without repercussions is a fallacy. Similarly, the assumption that human progress can be realized through capital accumulation and technological advancement to the exclusion of all other aspects of life has gone horribly wrong. It is neither possible to ignore the impact of ecological disasters nor assume that these disasters are caused by natural causes. The destruction of the Western Ghats has been not just because of illegal timber mining, smuggling, and sand excavation, but sadly because of the large infrastructure projects initiated by the state agencies. These many dubious projects have received environmental clearing in principle during the lockdown from the MOEFCC without proper negotiations. The proposed railways, highways, nuclear plants, river diversion projects, which specifically Karnataka wishes to have, will not only endanger wildlife, it will compromise food security and water security of people. The frequency of the environmental disasters is because of these flawed economic policies. These policies, as is well known, has a long history. It began with the tiny island nation, the British policies, who pillaged our natural resources without thought of the well-being of the people. The fallout of such exploitative policies was the impoverishment of local communities and the degradation of the biosphere. Uprooted by the increasing frequencies of natural calamities, vulnerable communities are alienated from their socio-cultural and physical environment. Forced to migrate from their homeland, they form the vast majority of the landless workers who crowd the cities in search of livelihood. My many years of working in the urban slums of Mumbai tells me that most of the people are migrants because of ecological devastation. Unfortunately, there's been no critical assessment of the direction of economic growth to be pursued in India after it gained independence. Overly impressed by the technical advances made by Western nations, Indian leaders unquestioningly followed a similar direction of growth to reach the goals of economic development carved out by Western nations. What was overlooked was Western nations could obtain their standard of economic progress because of the easy availabilities of raw materials from the country, from their colonized countries. When a country like India carves out a similar pathway of progress, it can only do so at the expense of their own people, particularly those living in the margins. The human cost of industrial capitalism was never acknowledged in dominant economic discourses. These theories have intended to justify the principles of domination and entitlements of the colonial overlords. It is the enthusiasm to replicate the level of prosperity seemingly enjoyed by Western societies that Indian elite allowed for the plunder of our own country. Gadgil and Guha have very rightly said, even after the colonial powers left India, the task left unfinished of destroying the earth and the lives of indigenous communities was enthusiastically taken up by the incoming nationalist elite, whose unswerving commitment to resource-intensive patterns of industrialization has only intensified the process of ecological and social disturbance initiated by the British. In order to force, no doubt, in post-independence India, in order to forestall some of the most devastating consequences of these policies, we've had a good social welfare policy. For instance, during the current pandemic, the disaster management plan focuses on helping people out of the disaster, providing medical aid, ensuring electricity is reconnected, ensuring that survivors are searched for and taken out, ensuring that food and water supply reaches those left without anything. And no doubt in Korgu, a lot of the devastation affected people have been given fresh houses and a new start in life. But what I need to add here is this help has reached people very selectively, because what is required in land use policy is the need for papers. And many of the indigenous communities who have lived and tilled the land for centuries do not have the necessary paper to be able to prove their land ownership. This has happened in other parts of India as well. Further, the land boundaries have been so thoroughly destroyed that they don't even know where their land, the boundaries exist. So what we also need to recognize is that the rural basis of the India's economy and the solution to the agricultural crisis is not through providing agricultural subsidies to farmers. These measures or to the disaster affected, these measures do not address the roots of the problem. The problems that the agriculture community faces is not because of falling crop prices, but the desertification of the countryside with ill-conceived projects. Successive governments have undermined the environmental regulation. What we have witnessed in post-independence India, particularly in the last 30 years, is a conflict between development policies, agriculture, and business policies. It is the nexus of the political and business interests which determines government decision to dissect the guts with infrastructure projects. Ironically, since independence, we have heard the rhetorics of agricultural basis of our economy, But unfortunately, the focus of development has been urban-centered. In the last few years, India has lost most of its forest cover, particularly in the last 30 years, and we only have a forest cover of about 21.34%. I do agree, I do not want to take more time. I would like to open up for discussion. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Professor Veena Punaja, for bringing in pertinent questions about the policies which are responsible for the unfavorable conditions in the environment, also for highlighting how environmental destructions are happening in the name of development. The apparent disregard for environment by implementing wrong forest policies, the large infrastructure projects, which we were not aware that have got sanctioned in the name of economic development. And to add to this, the human-centric approach that has destroyed the biodiversity of the Ghats. And the ecological devastation, another point was that ecological devastation is also responsible for people living in the villages coming to the cities. And so we have to question the role of the welfare state versus we know that we are living in a capitalistic economy. There are a number of questions that we have. We start with the first one. Shubharna wants to know if these are shocking details from Coorg, so why is media silent on this?
We are not politically active. Coorg is a very small rural community who have not the right people in the right position. And people in rural areas, like I agree, in 2018, everybody heard of Kerala. Everybody made much of what happened in Coorg. On the scale of a state, devastation of a state, of a powerful state with political power to get people to listen, we did not have that kind of power. Even today, the government is going ahead with land conversion, allowing agricultural land to be converted into commercial purposes. This is ridiculous because it will only destroy the rural economy even further. And I'm not saying Kodagu alone, along the Western Ghats, the rural districts which are in mountainous areas are going to be affected. I have not given the full tragedy of what happened in Kodagu because I wanted to focus on the policy. If you hear it shocking, because those who lost their lives in 2018 and 19 were not their house, they were totally impoverished, were not just the poor people with 4 acres of land or no land, but across the rich were brought to their knee, rich I mean the middle classes were also brought down to their knee. And then of course the land sharks come in and offer less than 50% of the prices for selling their land.
Okay. The second question is from Anita, and she wants to know what is the way forward by the environmentalists to conserve, by the environmental conservation?
Yes, it's a very complex question, and I'm glad you asked it. The key point is we have to forget about a greed-driven, economy-driven economy, you know, like a capital-driven economy, capital-intensive economy. And I think we just need to focus more on diversifying the economy. And what is required before initiating a project is sound, thought-provoking action, discussion to make sure you're not doing harm which cannot be undone. You know, clear guidelines. The environmentalists are not opposing development for the sake of opposing the government. They are doing it with a very specific cost. The governments also talk of sustainable development, but what they forget is the basis of sustainable development is based on the ecology protection. It begins with the environment.
LP is the third question is from LP. He wants to know, can you please shed some more light on migration due to ecological devastation and who migrates and how difficult or easy is for people from various classes to migrate?
See, I will not talk of the rich and the rich who migrate for better opportunities, who go forward to open up their ways to better lives. But we know from various studies that the Narmada devastation, the amount of devastation that the Narmada project happened. And when we lived in Bombay, we know that these people who come and land on the roadside and live without homes in the footpaths of Mumbai are really very often devastation victims. And the tragedy is, in the name of beautification of the place, we further uproot these people. The people who came, the migrant laborers who came to Mumbai to work here, did so because their own regions in Bihar, Orissa, etc., was not profitable for them. They needed to come out and earn a living in the city. And when the pandemic happened, the tragedy of their life is they were thrown out of Bombay. Bombay did not want to take responsibility for the people. I know from my various studies in Maharashtra, there are many villages in Maharashtra that do not have any people living except old people and children during work seasons. And that is for the construction workers, all the construction workers. I agree, they may give many causes for their migration, but at the heart of the problem is there are no economic opportunities there. The caste conflicts which arise is because of scarcity of resources. The gender violence that we hear, the increased incidence of gender violence during the pandemic is because of the frustrations that come out of the pandemic. So considering that the pandemic is also, or even before, because as resources get scarce, people start othering people. You know, either through identities of religion, caste, gender, etc., and target them for all acts of violence to get rid of their frustration instead of going to the root of the problem. There are two roots for this problem. One is the inequalities, which does not assure people their basic needs. And the other is the lack of livelihood, lack of water, and desertification of lands in different parts of India.
Okay. Megha Tomar wants to know, because development is necessary, so is there a way to have development without harming the environment?
I don't think we can think of development in terms of narrow economic goals of cash economy. We cannot talk of a society where the military might of a country is seen as the greatness of the country cannot be measured by its military might or its economic power. It can be seen only through justice, that is human justice to people, well-being of people. And this can primarily begin when we have stopped the environmental crisis. It has to begin with the environment. Farmers are committing suicide because there is no because of the erratic weather conditions. I read a post where people spoke of the problems coming out of Western nations and colonization. But we too are complicit in the destruction of the environment. And environment has to be protected if we want social justice and the overall well-being of communities and people.
Our next question comes from Dr. Puttul Sate. What is your opinion about the rise of Dalit environmentalists who have termed the movement as bourgeois, particularly Mukul Kesavan's book.
I beg your pardon, I didn't get the whole question.
She wants to know, what is your opinion about the rise of Dalit environmentalists? Specifically, they have termed the movement as bourgeois, and particularly, she's referring to Mukul Kesavan's book.
See, I don't want to comment on that. The point is, career environmentalists, that way we can say about any NGO group. There are career NGOs also, but do we not need a broad civil society? We need to have greater discussions between the community, people, greater participation, more democracy at the grassroots level. I can't comment on a few people whom, Putul, you call as career environmentalists. You did refer to, I don't want to comment on it, but the key problem is environment is a concern. It's got nothing to do with the politics of the environment. Without the earth, without sustainability of the earth, we do not have a planet to live in. And the poor pay the greatest price.
Hello, Veena. Can I just intervene? I was very, because this was recently a debate where you had Nivedita Menon commenting the whole debate between civilization and development. And then this debate is something which is being heard among the conflict, the long-standing debate, I should say, or the dialectics between Ambedkarite position and Gandhi's position. You know, it's actually coming idea of village and the Dalit saying that. I thought since we are talking about this, I thought I'll just just know that, of course, these are all very highly contentious issues. There are no point. And also,
clear
I think
answers. No, I agree with you, Putul. These are contentious issues and both are equally necessary. It's a dialectic. We need to get together and have further discussions.
Right.
Not fossilize one opinion or the other. Human rights and opportunities for the marginalized communities is a priority. But the fact of the matter is also that Gandhiji too thought of the village economy, the village sustenance of people, because what he spoke about was village level democracy and the coming together of people. So I think we need to reconsider also, along with the rights paradigm put forward by Ambedkar, we also need to take into consideration the community-centered paradigm which Gandhiji put forward. Because his viewpoint of development, something which J.C. Kumarappa developed further, the well-known Gandhian economist Kumarappa developed further, was
placed. It has a lot of impact on
Divya, I can hear your voice.
Yeah.
Yes. I just wanted to know that though you have got a very good presentation and you projected very well that how deforestation and environmental degradation and all other things, you know, faulty policies of government have further led to the impact on our indigenous communities. Now, my question is that where do women stand in Karnataka to further stop this devastation, natural resources, and how do we have...
I can't really answer this question because women too are part of the environmental group. And we do know from various studies where you have also taken on sanitation and even water, which we have done earlier at the RCWS, we do know that water is a woman's issue. And I would say in the various environmental groups I see in Kodagu, women are very active and very concerned. But as we said, that we are a voiceless lot because we don't have the political power to be heard. We are constantly shouted down. When Colonel Muthanna carried out a rally against the railways, for instance, we were shouted down by various pro-development groups who thought more of getting a road to their house rather than thinking of the trees which were lost. And the government solution was the reforestation of trees. Trees, these are ancient forests which have existed since the beginning of time. How can you think of destroying it and replanting eucalyptus or any other commercial trees? Yeah. There are so people fighting, I can say.
My question is that how do we stop this further, you know?
We have to give more attention to eco-feminist positions of, Vandana Shiva and various other people who have discussed it.
Yeah.
Eco-feminism is the solution. We cannot do without it. If we want rights for the people, if we want to make sure that they don't have to struggle for water, if we want our cities to be without water supply, you know, the future wars are going to be on water.
And to give the voice
directly linked with the forests,
and to give the voice to the indigenous people, actually.
Exactly.
You know?
Absolutely. You know, unfortunately, indigenous, see, the new migrants into areas like ancient lands like Kodagu get papers when they buy a house. We saw it in Bombay also, but the ancient fisher community, etc., who have been plying their trade, they are being pushed out. We saw it in various studies. And also here, the people have tilled their lands for centuries. Now, if any of us want to register our land, we have to produce the purchase paper. How do people who hold Jamma land prove their land ownership? And when their land is destroyed, how do they prove that they own the land? They don't get compensation. The real indigenous people don't get compensation. This is my experience here. Those who get compensation are those who can prove that they lived there with their necessary papers.
No, it's a very good presentation, Veena, I must say, but you brought a lot of things into the picture. But still, we feel that something from the point of view of policy making had to be changed somewhere, you know.
Absolutely.
It's very difficult otherwise.
It is further
devastation of resources going to take place.
Very true. We have no hope for the future. See, if we just take Gadgil committee report, gave a thought 60% of the Western Ghats should be protected as, you know, ecologically sensitive zone. Kasturi Rangan brought it down to 37%. And even this minuscule amount which needed to be protected is seen as anti-development. Where are the rains?
Yeah.
How many farmers are going to die? Who is going to speak for them?
And the present government is also, you know, only emphasizing on infrastructure development. So you even see in the Maharashtra what is happening. The big deforestation is taking place for the railway, for everything. Only development, infrastructure development.
Absolutely right, Divya. Absolutely right. You're absolutely right. And poor Maharashtra, poor Mumbai especially is sinking.
Yes.
It provides the maximum revenue for the country. And where are the people? 60% of our people are forced to live in slums.
Yeah.
It is
very scenario.
It has very,
very
close quarters. It's so demeaning. They are fighting to go to the loo. Is a big fight. They have to stand in a queue to get a chance to go to the loo. Women fall ill because of lack of sanitation. Why do we need these congregations of people, you know, living in such dehumanized condition?
Veena ma'am, we have one question from maybe you have already answered that, but maybe you can elaborate. Meher Jyoti wants to know, what is the role of environment, ecology, and social movements for preventing ecological devastation of the Western Ghats? So how can we prevent it? She's talking about the social movements.
Very true. It's a wonderful question, Meher Jyoti. I think it's it was people's movements which can stop development, illegal development, illegal construction. Please remember, most of the landslides in Dakshina Kannada, Mangalore region has come about after the Konkan Railway. And what is happening in the heart of the forest, no one is talking about. People have to resist. People have to raise the voice. People have to be conscious to prevent, to protect the rights which are being taken away from them. That's the only way.
Okay. Thank you so much, Professor Veena Punacha, for this enriching presentation and for bringing in so many issues in the forefront. I will request Dr. Puttul Sate, head of department, to say a few words.
So thank you, Veena. That was really a wonderful talk. And I think we got a very local view, you know, because we often get very wide pictures of what is happening. But I thought that your presentation was very unique because it gave us specific information, but pertaining to a particular locale, you know, and the fact that, every region needs a different kind of a solution, or rather a different kind of an approach. So on behalf of the department, I thank Professor Veena Punacha. So on this note, we come to an end. We come to an end today, and I look forward to meeting the participants tomorrow. Tomorrow also we have a lecture at the same time by Dr. Smita Patel. Thank you, Veena, once more, and goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.